Hello Internet, let's continue our repair of the Pentax Electro Spotmatic. We would like to proceed to checking the light sensitivity of the camera, but last time we found that there are contact problems in the battery compartment and they were unfortunately not resolved by deoxidizing the contacts. So it looks like I will have to open the front of the camera, which I would have liked to avoid because this camera is in almost perfect cosmetic conditions. And I wanted to avoid taking off the leatherette, but we do not have another choice. I suspect that there is a broken solder joint. And while we are in there, maybe we can also fix the other problem that the battery contact spring sometimes makes a connection to the chassis, shorting out the battery. I have already removed the lens and the battery, and I will proceed to open the top of the camera as a preparation for removing the front. Now we see the little distribution board, from which I will have to desolder some wires in order to disconnect the front electrically from the camera body. I reinstalled the film speed and exposure compensation dial. Let's apply a bit of new solder to hopefully make the removal of the wires a little easier. That was rather easy. I just have to remember that the green wire is on the outermost right. Black wire was in the center and the yellow wire was on the left. The next step is to peel off the leatherette. I hope this will go well. I will start at the hinges. It is coming, but I think I will carefully warm the glue to make it come off a little bit easier. I will be using the lowest setting on my heat gun, which is 100 degrees Celsius. It's really not that hot. I can comfortably hold my hand rather close to the nozzle. I hope I got this part off without damaging it or deforming it too much. I think it already had a small cut here. I got it out fine, and after this was removed, the rest was very easy. You see there's not a lot of glue here. The hole I noticed in the other camera that was plugged by a little metal plate is here just open, so no metal plate came out below the leatherette. Maybe there never was one, or maybe this was already lost by someone who opened the camera before. I'm also not sure if all the glue here is original. Now that the leatherette is off, we should be able to remove the front cover. Just try to get some of the gunk out of the screws. Oh, these screws are quite tight. Might have some kind of thread lock on them. Good thing that these screwdrivers match the screws exactly, otherwise it would be quite probable that the screws would get damaged. This is the smaller screw. A tiny washer comes out with it. For each of the screws, I remove the washer. Now the front should come off. Voila. This is the solder connection that I suspect to maybe be bad. The spring washers that might come out of these holes. They don't seem to want to, so let's leave them in there. Let's see if I can remove the battery compartment by removing this screw here. That would make it much easier to handle for the repair. And yes, the whole battery compartment just slips out. I did some organizing of the screws off camera. What I want to do now is to check the contact of this contact spring to the back here. So either this solder joint is the problem, or the problem is between the battery compartment and this contact here in the camera. This really looks like a cold solder joint to me. Most probably the solder joint is broken underneath where the spring comes out from the battery compartment. So I will definitely re-solder this. Let's desolder the spring. I really want to get this spring out of here so I can solve the other problem with the spring touching the chassis. I just am quite afraid to break this spring because the last part of it here is bent over quite sharply. How annoying. What I want to do now is to put some insulating sleeve on this outer part of the spring winding to prevent it touching the chassis. Now, of course, the spring eventually broke, but I think I could rescue it by soldering a piece of copper wire to it. And I also isolated the outermost winding of the spring with some heat shrink to avoid contact to the chassis. I think I will put the battery in there to hold it. Let's test contact before we solder. We see perfect contact. I see the full battery voltage. increase the heat. I got a very nice connection. What I'm not so keen on is that I got quite a lot of solder now on this contact pad here. So this makes for an uneven contact surface for the spring and the camera. I think I ended up with a good result. I removed some of the solder and now I have a perfect connection and also a flat contact surface here for the spring and the camera. The battery fits in there nicely, there's no more danger of a short circuit to chassis. So I will clean the contact surfaces with some IPA and reinstall the battery compartment in the front of the camera. Let's also quickly clean the contact spring in the camera. I checked that all the washers are still there. Making sure not to pinch any of the wires. Now let's check continuity for our newly repaired battery compartment. Perfect, there's no more intermittent contact. Even if I wiggle the contact spring, let's check it with the battery. I see the full battery voltage between chassis and the input of the shutter release switch. Perfect. I think the two problems we found with the battery compartment are solved. Unfortunately, we now have this mess of the removed leatherette and so on. I will not reapply the leatherette now, but only when I'm completely finished. And then I also can show you how I glue the leatherette back on. Now that we have the camera top open, I can show you that under the shutter release button, there's a little plunger that is now inside here. And this can easily come loose. So take care not to lose this part. This is the part that interacts with the cable release when a cable release is screwed in the shutter release button. You can now also see the sync contacts that go to the hot shoe. And the hot shoe is actually quite a complicated construction. There is a safety contact that needs to be activated by pushing something into the hot shoe. So there are little plastic punches on both sides under the springs here. And they activate the contact that actually makes the connection between the hot shoe center contact and these little contacts here. So don't be surprised if you check continuity and you find that they are not connected. You need to insert some little pieces of plastic or wood on the sides of the hot shoe here to close the connection. This is of course so that if an external flash is connected on the front of the camera in these sync contacts, that there isn't high voltage exposed on the center hot shoe contact.
We are now in my darkroom and we are ready to test the light sensitivity of the camera. I cleaned and reassembled the camera and I mounted it on the test setup. whenever you test the light sensitivity, it is important that the camera top is installed, because otherwise you have too much stray light entering the sensors. Actually, it's best to even cover the viewfinder, because the stray light entering the viewfinder from behind can have a significant impact on the measurement by the camera. We will be measuring three quantities and their dependence on the light entering the lens of the camera. The first is the resistance of the CDS elements. They will be measured in parallel as they are wired in the camera. So for now, we will not be able to distinguish between the left and the right element. The second quantity is the voltage at pin 9. This is the result of log compression. And the third is the voltage at the source of the JFET buffer transistor. For my test setup, I have built a light controller with two powerful LED units illuminating the field of view of the camera. I can regulate the light output continuously to create a wide range of illuminance from about EV1 up to EV15.5. I use my Pentax digital spot meter to measure the illuminance that the camera sees. While I'm taking the measurements here, I will show you two reference sections explaining how the camera is supposed to work, which will make it much easier for you to follow along when we interpret the results later. The photosensitive elements available at the beginning of the 1970s were quite large, which makes it difficult to place them in the camera without obstructing too much of the optical path. The solution that the Asahi engineers chose was to put the light sensitive elements inside the viewfinder housing to the left and to the right of the actual eyepiece. These photoresistive elements receive part of the same light that is scattered by the focusing screen, redirected by the pentaprism, and that forms the visible viewfinder image. While the user is looking through the viewfinder, you want the aperture of the lens to be at its maximum in order to create a viewfinder image that is as bright as possible and a depth of field that is as shallow as possible for correct focusing. However, when the picture is actually taken, the amount of light actually hitting the film will be less than the amount of light that previously formed the image in the viewfinder. There are in principle two solutions. The first is called stop-down metering. That was the approach taken by earlier Spotmatic models. The user operates a lever that closes the aperture down to the preset value, and then the light measurement is taken. The other, more modern approach is open aperture metering. Light is metered with the aperture at its maximum, and the camera automatically compensates for the effect of the preset aperture when the picture is taken. Interestingly, the Pentax Electro Spotmatic supports both of these solutions. The second problem resulting from the placement of the photoresistive elements is mirror blackout. Shortly before the picture is actually taken, the camera mirror swings upwards, making the viewfinder appear black for a short time. So the photoresistive elements cannot take a correct measurement when the picture is actually taken. The camera electronics therefore need some way to remember the value of the measurement that was taken before the user pressed the shutter release. Another difficulty generally faced by camera electronics is when a picture is taken in full sunlight, there may be several thousand times the amount of light entering the camera than when you take a picture at candlelight. This is a great challenge, especially for the analog electronics used at the beginning of the 1970s, because it means that
While the electronics must be able to deal with the full range of values up to very bright sunlight, they must also be precise enough to correctly respond to the comparatively tiny differences between situations like candlelight and normal electric interior lighting. On a scale on which full sunlight can be represented, the difference between candlelight and interior electric lighting, which is in relative terms quite significant, so it's two stops difference, is in absolute terms hardly noticeable. This means that parts of the electronics that deal with voltages that are proportional or indirectly proportional to the absolute amount of light must be designed to have very low noise and to have very tight tolerances. To understand the principle of operation of the electronics, we will first look at a simplified schematic that captures the main ideas behind the circuit. We will later go on to discuss all the details. The blue circled numbers that you see in this schematic refer to the pins of the 12-pin connector on the circuit board, with pin 1 being the one closest to the center of the camera. We begin in a state where you have the shutter cocked and the release button lightly depressed in order to activate the exposure measurement. In this state, the contact going to pin 3 is closed. The contact going from pin 4 to ground is also closed, and the contact between the supply voltage and the solenoid and pin 10 is open. In this state, the mirror is down and the CDS element receives scattered light from the focusing screen. The resistance of the CDS element is roughly inversely proportional to the illuminance. We will later discuss deviations from this approximate behavior. The current flowing through the photoresistor is roughly proportional to the illuminance, that is, roughly proportional to the intensity of light going into the camera. The circuit will reach a steady state in which we can ignore current going this way for the following reasons. The input of the comparator here is very high impedance, so there will be no current flowing this way, approximately. And this way we have only the capacitor C2. So as soon as this capacitor has finished charging, there will be no current flowing along this branch. So we can neglect this current and only look at the current going through this Zener diode. This Zener diode has a crucial function that is referred to as log compression, a clever technique for dealing with the very high range of illuminances that the circuit has to work with. Let's look at the relation of the current through a diode and the voltage across the diode. When we draw the current as a function of the voltage, a diode has roughly an exponential voltage-current curve, that is, the current is approximately an exponential function of the voltage across the diode. If we take the inverse function, that is, we plot the voltage across the diode as a function of the current through the diode, we get approximately a logarithmic dependence. The voltage across the diode is approximately a logarithmic function of the current through the diode. Note that this graph shows exact mathematical exponential and logarithmic functions, and the behavior of a real diode is only an approximation to these functions. But for our first simplified discussion, we can ignore the deviations. We know that the current through the diode is roughly proportional to the illuminance. Consequently, the voltage across the diode will be roughly proportional to the logarithm of the illuminance up to a constant offset voltage that we are going to ignore for now. The logarithm of the illuminance is proportional to the exposure value that unfortunately is abbreviated as EV, which can be confused here with the standard notation for illuminance, E sub V. So sorry for this coincidence. I will try to write it as clearly as possible. The exposure value is a logarithmic measure of light that increases by one for every doubling of the amount of light. Consequently, the voltage at pin 9 will increase by a fixed increment for each doubling of light. To give you an idea of the order of magnitude, for each doubling of light, voltage UD will increase by 135 millivolts per doubling. That is, the voltage at pin 9 increases by 135 millivolts per stop of light. The next step that the circuit has to take is to take into account all the other factors apart from the amount of light that influence the correct exposure time. These factors are the sensitivity of the film, that is the ASA setting, the exposure compensation dialed in by the user, and the preset aperture set on the lens. Note that for the time being, we will only discuss the open aperture metering mode. The ASA setting and the exposure compensation are mechanically combined and they operate one potentiometer. There is a second potentiometer in form of the potentiometer ring sensing the aperture setting of the lens. These two potentiometers are connected as voltage dividers to a constant floating supply voltage. This makes this floating voltage divider basically act as an analog calculator. For each stop that the aperture is closed down relative to the wide open aperture, this divider will subtract about 135 millivolts per stop of the aperture being stopped down. This divider connected to the ASA dial will increase the voltage by 135 millivolts for each stop of film sensitivity or exposure compensation setting. Overall, the voltage reaching pin 3 will be the voltage at pin 9, that is proportional to the exposure value, minus and plus these offset values that take into account the preset aperture and the ASA setting and the exposure compensation. The voltage applied at pin 3 that is used to charge this capacitor C2 is a logarithmic measure for the correct exposure time, that is 135 millivolts higher for each stop of shorter exposure time. Overall, once the circuit has reached a steady state, this capacitor C2 that is connected to ground on one side will have been charged to a voltage that has approximately the following mathematical form. It is minus 135 millivolts times the base 2 logarithm of the desired exposure time t, plus some constant that we are going to ignore for now. It is minus because for longer exposure times, the voltage is lower. Note that the voltage across this capacitor can be both positive or negative relative to ground. negative voltages can be achieved due to this being powered by a floating voltage supply that can move below ground of the main circuit. In the steady state, when C2 has finished charging, there is no current flowing here, meaning that these voltage dividing potentiometers constitute unloaded resistive dividers. That means that the voltages that are tapped here at these potentiometers will be exactly proportional to the settings of the potentiometers. This whole part of the circuit is powered by a regulated voltage supply. It means that all the voltages here representing the photographic parameters will also be largely independent of the actual battery voltage. While all of this is going on, there's another important point of the circuit that independently reaches its steady state. It is this part around the capacitor C1, and it's independent in this state because pin 4 is grounded. So this branch and this branch of the circuit both go to ground with low impedance here. So in this state, their behavior is decoupled. This is also ensured by this part of the circuit being supplied by a separate regulated voltage supply that I have called V charge here, around, let's say, 2.2 volts relative to ground. In the steady state, the current going into this capacitor will approach zero. So we only have to look at the current going through this resistor, through this resistor, through the diode and into ground. Pin 1 is open and unused on the connector, so there is no current going this way. We will have a fixed constant current that causes a little bit of a voltage drop across this resistor. So this node will stabilize somewhat below the V charge regulated voltage, and this will also be the voltage to which capacitor C1 is charged. Finally, we need to look at the remaining part of the circuit on the right here. This consists of a comparator and a switching transistor connected to the solenoid. The negating terminal of the comparator is connected to the pin 3 node, so it receives the voltage encoding the desired exposure time. The non-negating input receives a fixed preset reference voltage, something like 1.8 volt, for example. And normally the circuit is adjusted so that the voltage at the pin 3 node is always below this reference voltage, at least in normal lighting conditions. Therefore, the output will go high, meaning that this transistor will be turned on. However, in the current state, no current is flowing here because this electrical conduct is still open, so the solenoid is not yet activated. Now, with the steady state of the circuit established, as we have discussed, we get to the point of the user releasing the shutter. The first thing that will happen is that the mirror swings upwards. The contacts that are below the mirror box will change state. The contact going to pin 3 opens, and the contact going to pin 10 closes. Capacitor C2 is now completely decoupled from the photoresistive element and the resistive divider. That means that the voltage at C2 will no longer be influenced by the amount of light received by the photoresistive elements, which is just as well, because now that the mirror swings up, the viewfinder will get dark and the resistance of the photoresistor will no longer correspond to the light actually being used for taking the picture. Furthermore, since the input of the comparator is very high impedance, current from the capacitor C2 has nowhere to go, and so capacitor C2 will maintain its current charge to very high precision. This capacitor will therefore store or remember this voltage U3 that encodes the desired exposure time. That's why we may call C2 the storage capacitor in the system. Now that the contact to pin 10 is closed, current will flow from the battery supply through the solenoid and through the switching transistor that is turned on, as we have discussed in this state. So the solenoid will be energized, and that means it will keep the little pin on top of the solenoid from moving, meaning that the second shutter curtain will not be able to pass when it approaches the pin, which it does not yet do, but it will do soon. The state, it remembers the voltage here and it pre-energizes the solenoid. When the mirror has swung up completely, the camera is ready to release the first shutter curtain. As soon as the first shutter curtain is released, another electrical contact will change state, namely the contact going from pin 4 to ground will open. This is the precise timing signal that tells the circuit that from now on the first curtain is running. We have the solenoid energized and blocking the second curtain from entering the frame and closing the shutter. We also have this node disconnected from ground, which completely changes the behavior of the circuit here, because now C1 and C2 are no longer decoupled by this low impedance link to ground. Instead, this node will also have very high impedance to ground now, meaning that practically no current can flow here as well as here. And as we already discussed, close to zero current can flow here. Because pin 1 is open, also no more current can flow here, meaning that the voltage drop that we had across this transistor on the order of 30 millivolts will go to zero. Because we have no current flowing here, here, and here. And right at the beginning, the capacitor C1 still is charged too close to the V-charge voltage. The only thing that changes is the disappearance of this voltage drop here. And this whole part of the circuit will move up in potential by this amount that the voltage drop was earlier. So this node will almost immediately move up by 30 millivolts or so. This is a small change and does not yet affect the comparator, but it is something that can be observed when you look at the right signals in the circuit with an oscilloscope. The next thing that we need to consider is that while there is no current flowing here and here, current may very well flow inside this loop. So we will get current flowing in this loop and discharging capacitor C1. Discharging C1 via a diode constitutes another clever technique referred to as log expansion. The name suggesting that this will be the inverse operation to log compression that we had at the first diode. Due to the exponential dependence of the current through the diode on the voltage across the diode, the discharge curve of capacitor C1 will quite closely approximate a logarithmic function. In fact, here I have an actual scope capture that I took from one of the circuit boards. And you can see that the voltage at pin 3 first makes this tiny jump that we discussed, which is almost impossible to see here, so the 30 millivolts, and then it follows a curve that at least in the in its middle regions quite closely approximates a logarithmic function of time. We discussed earlier that the voltage across the storage capacitor C2, which initially is the same as the voltage at pin 3 to ground, is a multiple of the base 2 logarithm of the desired exposure time plus some constant offset. The voltage across the storage capacitor will remain constant. Now that the capacitor C1 is being discharged, this node here will move up in potential. This means that also the voltage at pin 3 will move up by the same amount. And we see this here, that we get this logarithmic increase with time of the voltage at pin 3. At some point in time, it will reach the reference voltage and will cause the comparator to swing. The amount of time it takes to reach that point is an exponential function of the initial voltage difference between the initial voltage at pin 3 and the reference voltage. This difference in voltage will initially be a positive multiple of the log 2 exposure time. If you take the exponential of this, you will get that this time will be, if all constants are chosen adequately, will be equal to the desired exposure time. So exactly after the desired exposure time has expired, the voltage at pin 3 will cross this reference voltage threshold and the comparator will swing. Its output will become low, causing the switching transistor to be turned off. This will stop the current flowing through the solenoid, causing the magnetic field of the solenoid to break down and freeing the pin on top of the solenoid. The pin can now move out of the way of the second curtain, and the second curtain will enter the frame and proceed to close the shutter, ending the exposure time. So let's take a look at the results for light values from EV1 up to EB15 and 2/3 and back again to EV1. I recorded the resistance between pins 9 and 7 of the CDS elements. The voltage at pin 9, the voltage at the JFET buffer source, and I recorded what the meter in the camera viewfinder indicates. This is written as powers of 2, so for example 9 means 1 over 2 to the 9th seconds, which is about a 500th of a second. I also recorded a second table with a constant light value of EB14. This time varying the film speed setting and the exposure compensation settings. In table form, the results are not very illuminating, but you may be surprised how much we can find out about the camera by analyzing this data. I first made some consistency checks based on the data at a constant EV14, and they proved that we get very stable measurements of the resistance and voltages. Next, let's take a look at the big picture. I have here on the horizontal scale the actual EV set on the light controller and on the vertical scale what the camera meter indicated. And it doesn't look good. The points should be on the dotted line, but we see that the light sensitivity of the camera is completely off and it also varies across the EV range. Even for the higher EV values, where the camera is more sensitive, it reacts way too little to changes in light, as we can see on the too small slope of this curve. Overall, the light sensitivity is completely wrong, and our job is now to find out which component is at fault. Looking at the voltage at pin 9, things look equally bad. This plot here should be a straight line if the camera would be working correctly. But what we see is that as we get to lower and lower light values, the light sensitivity of the camera decreases until it hardly reacts to the light at all. Even for the higher values, the response is way too shallow. I plotted the voltage difference per stop in this plot below, and we see that even for the high light values, it stays below about 100 millivolts per stop, which is not enough. And for the lower values, it goes almost to zero. The voltages at pin 9 strongly point to a broken CDS element. So let's directly look at the CDS resistance. Here we have a doubly logarithmic plot showing the light intensity as EVs. And on a vertical logarithmic scale, we see the resistance of the CDS elements. The blue dots are the measured values. And we see that only for the higher values, they stay on a straight line. In such a doubly logarithmic plot, a power law dependence shows up as a straight line. A working CDS element would show up as points on a straight line, like the gray ones here. The gray dots are data I measured from the CDS element of another Pentax Electro Spotmatic, albeit the slope is quite shallow, but at least the dependence on the light is very linear in this doubly logarithmic plot, which means that the CDS element shows a clean power law dependence of its resistance on the light. One problem is that modern CDS elements that you can buy today look more like the cyan line. They have a much stronger dependence on the light, resulting in a steeper slope here. And you can also see that the curve is somewhat bent, meaning that the light sensitivity changes over the range of light values, with the element becoming more sensitive towards the lower light values. I have also fitted a power law to the higher EV value portion of the measured values. And from this, we get an exponent of the light dependence of minus 0.27. And from analysis further down, we will see that this exponent is too small, meaning that the CDS element is not light sensitive enough. It is clear from these results that at least one of the CDS elements in the camera is broken and that the CDS elements will have to be replaced. Next, I analyzed the characteristics of the Zener diode used for log compression. We see here in a logarithmic plot the IV curve of the Zener diode, and it is almost a perfectly straight line. The magenta line is a linear model matched to the data, and from this I extracted the average voltage increase per doubling of the current. It is 251 millivolts. We also see, if we look very closely, that the slope of the diode curve varies very slightly over the voltage range. The dotted line is a second order model fitted to the data, and using this model we can see that the voltage increase per current doubling changes somewhat. This is important because it means that the voltage increase per current doubling at the Zener diode can be calibrated by putting the operating point at different voltages by trimming the overall VREC supply voltage. But you see that the difference in slope is quite small and is not at all sufficient for compensating a CDS element that is not light sensitive enough. Only when the CDS elements are almost perfectly matched to the other components in a camera can this varying slope be used to calibrate the response perfectly. Let's look at the voltage at the source of the JFET buffer transistor and its dependence on the pin 9 voltage. The JFET buffer is a voltage follower that is put in the circuit between the storage capacitor and the metering and comparator circuits. Its purpose is to provide an extremely high input impedance
to the storage capacitor. An ideal voltage buffer would just pass through the input voltage to its output unmodified, but that is not achievable with a JFET transistor. The best that the JFET can achieve is a linear dependence of the output voltage on its input. And we see in our data that for the lower pin 9 voltage range, the relation is actually quite nicely linear, but then there is a strange variation in the voltage until it settles to be almost linear again with a slightly steeper slope. So what is going on here? I could reproduce this behavior in an LTSpice simulation of the JFET buffer, and we see that the simulated circuit shows exactly the same transitioning behavior between a lower portion with a slope of 0.7 volts per volt to a higher portion with a somewhat higher slope of 0.8 volts per volt. Here's the simulation showing the full behavior of the JFET buffer. We see the gate voltage in green and the resulting source voltage in red. The gate voltage is for the most part identical to the voltage at pin 3, because in a normal operating region no current is flowing through the 2K resistor. The first thing we see is typical of a voltage buffer built with an n-channel JFET, namely that the output voltage is actually higher than the input voltage in most of the operating region. And we also see that the output voltage has a shallower slope than the input voltage. So the gain of the JFET buffer is below 1. Let's look at the various regions of the operation of the JFET buffer. For very low gate voltages, the JFET closes completely and the output voltage at the source goes to 0. Then there is a transitional region in which the dependence of the output on the input voltage is quite non-linear. So that's a region we will not want to use normally in this application. For very high gate voltages, the gate voltage actually crosses the source voltage and the gate source junction of the JFET transistor becomes forward biased. This is unwanted because the JFET cannot operate in this region and a large current starts to flow from the gate to the source. Let's plot the gate current, and we see that in this region it starts to rise rapidly. Forward biasing the gate source junction in this way can easily damage a JFET, so it's a good thing that the Asahi engineers put a current limiting resistor before the gate of the JFET. Normally, the JFET should not be operated in this region at all. It should only be operated in the region where the gate source junction is reverse biased. Clearly, the normal operating range of the voltage buffer should be somewhere between here and here, where we have an almost linear dependence of the output voltage on the input voltage and the gate source diode is reverse biased. But what about this strange bump that we see within the operating region? There's an upward bump here and then a somewhat smaller downward bump here, and in between the slope of the output voltage is somewhat lower than in the rest of the operating region. Well, these imperfections are the result of the loading of the buffer output by the comparator circuit that comes afterwards. The JFET is not a perfect voltage buffer. It has a very nice, very high input impedance, but its output impedance is not zero as it would be for an ideal buffer. So the loading of the output has some influence on the output voltage. But why this strange behavior with these two transition points? Well, that becomes clear when we look at the operation of the comparator circuit. Let's plot the currents through resistors R9 and R10. For low input voltages, only transistor Q3 is conducting, and we see a high current through resistor R10 and zero current through resistor R9. For high input voltages, we have the opposite situation. Only transistors Q1 and Q2 are conducting, and we see a high current through resistor R9 and zero current through resistor R10. In the middle, we have a strange transition region in which both sides of the comparator are conducting current. And it is exactly in this range that we see this bump on the output voltage. It comes on when we enter the transition region, and it fades out when we go out of the transition region again. And it is this part of the curve that we see in our measurements of the camera. When we zoom in, we can clearly see the transition from one linear portion to another approximately linear portion with this transitional shape in between. The correct operating range of the chafed buffer is the approximately linear region below the threshold of the comparator. The upper end of this operating range, where the comparator starts to swing, corresponds to very high light values, where an exposure of 1/1000th of a second is appropriate. Only for even higher light values should we cross into the transition region. And what we see in the camera that we tested is that this camera is always in this very high region. This fits our observation that the shutter time of the camera is always very short, independent of the light input. Now for some good news. If we look at what the meter in the viewfinder indicates in dependence on the source voltage, we see a very linear behavior of the meter up to some reading error that is about a 20th of a stop on average. So the meter seems to be perfectly fine, it's just calibrated wrongly. Finally, I checked the behavior of the resistive divider responsible for the film speed and exposure compensation settings by analyzing the data that was taken at a constant light value of EV14 with varying settings for film speed and exposure compensation. And we see that the divider is working almost perfectly. It gives a linear response, about 75 millivolts per stop. This shows that the potentiometer is working fine. It is just that the resistive divider is trimmed to a too small increment per stop. This first series of measurements already told us quite a lot about the camera. We know that we'll have to replace the CDS photoresistors and that the camera needs recalibration. Of course, calibration only makes sense after all the broken elements have been replaced. We also found that a lot of the circuitry is working fine, for example the Zener diode used in log compression, the potentiometer in the film speed setting, and the meter indicating the exposure time in the viewfinder. The chafed buffer and the comparator circuit are probably working fine according to the indications we saw. And we have a preliminary measurement of the chafed buffer gain as 0.75, which is a reasonable value. In the next part, we will work on replacing the CDS elements. So see you then. This video is dedicated to my father, who is a lifelong Pentax enthusiast. He owns the cameras and he has also provided for the quite significant costs of this project. So thank you, Dad.